Hello students, welcome. Now in this whole session we're going to talk about the chemical bonding. So before we should go ahead, we should know what are the objective of this session. So let's discuss what are the objective of this session first. So in this whole session we're going to talk about the what is chemical bonding, types of chemical bonding, then we're going to talk about ionic bonding and what is covalent bonding. So our whole session will be go around on these 4 points. Okay. So let's begin with the session. Okay. So what is chemical bonding, students? When you talk about the bonding, that means something has to be bonded, joined together. They have affinity towards each other. We know that. But when you talk about the chemical bonding, that simply means that there has some chemical format between those atoms, molecules, or that entity. So let's talk about what is a chemical bonding. So before we should go ahead, we should know about what is the history. The concept of chemical bonding was recognized as early as the 12th century, that certain types of chemical species were joined by the type of chemical affinity. So this is how about early 12th century we just coined the name chemical bonding. So chemical bond results from the strong electrostatic interaction between the two atoms. So what is the electrostatic interaction? Whenever there is a positive charge and negative charge is known as the electrostatic force of attractions or interaction. So now what is the chemical bond result from? This is a strong electrostatic bond. So let's discover this with the help of the whiteboard. Okay. So see here, if this is a one atom, this is a second atom, they have a strong force of attraction between them. And that force is known as electrostatic force. So that has to be one positive and one has to be the negative atom. So this is how it works and it's called a strong force of attraction, or we can say interactions. Okay. So a chemical bond results from the strong electrostatic force of attraction. We just know this now. Now let's move further. The nature of the atoms determine the kind of bond. The covalent bond results from the strong interaction between the neutral atom. So we have to understand here, the covalent bond results from the strong interaction neutral atoms between the neutral atoms. Now here the word neutral means there is no charge, but actually they share the electron and they complete their octet or duplet, and that's why they are called as a neutral one. See, we have seen that in the case of atoms, molecules, they when they combine to form, see, atoms combine to form molecule, molecules combine to form compound, they have a neutral charge or net zero charge they possess. What's that exactly? We will learn about in the whole session. So right now we just concentrated on covalent bond results from the strong interaction force between the interaction of the neutral atoms. Each atom donates an electron, resulting in a pair of electrons that are shared between the two electrons. So in this case, we have to understand something that is donation or the acceptance. So what is exactly donation and acceptance? So here, one electron is, so for example, sodium is here, the electron is revolving around the last shell electron, and the chlorine is here. Okay, now what happened? The electron is donated by the sodium, so it's called electron donor, that is a metal, and the chlorine, which is a non-metal, accept the electron. So here what happened? The sodium donated electron, which gained by the chlorine atom. This is what happened in this case, correct? So what is the exactly meaning of this? The each atom donates an electron, resulting in a pair of electron. That means one atom donates the electron towards the another atom, and they actually form the bond. This is the interpretation of this sentences. Okay, so for example, consider the hydrogen molecule. When you talk about the hydrogen molecule, it will be represented as a H2, but we should know about it is a formation of H and H bonding. So what does that exactly see here? When the two hydrogen bond, that is the H atoms, are far apart from each other, they do not feel any interaction. Suppose hydrogen atom is here, one is here, they are not going to form a bond. But when they are closer to each other, they are going to form a bond. That interpretation of what the bond, that is chemical bonding, actually acting on a short distance. Okay, so what is that? The electron on each hydrogen atom occupies a volume that covers both the hydrogen atom, and a covalent bond is formed. Once the bond has been formed, the two electrons are shared by both the hydrogen atom. So this one hydrogen atom having one electron is revolving. This is the second one, but they when come closer, they actually share the bond. So how it's they share? Let's see the example. See, this is the electron density. See, you can see a positive charge here. That is one hydrogen atom. Another is here. That is another hydrogen atom. What happened in this case? In this case, they actually come closer, and the electrons are what now revolving. So it's called electron density of the hydrogen molecule. See, student, understand this concept very well. This is very, very important. See, an electron density plot of hydrogen molecule shows that the shared electron occupy the volume equally distributed. Earlier, what happened? See, we'll show you by the whiteboard. So earlier we can say, let's take this is one hydrogen and this is another hydrogen. Earlier they far from each other, but when they actually come closer, they actually share the electrons. How? See, I will show you by this. The electron is revolving around this of this hydrogen atom, and in case of second hydrogen atom, like this. What happened? Whenever they come closer, now electron can be moved according to this manner. Yes or no, students? And that is called as electron density. And this is in front of you. Have you understood right now? Yes, that is called electron density. Can we move further? Yes. So now let's talk about the factors affecting this. So what are the factors determine if an atom forms a covalent or ionic bond? How can you say the atom is forming ionic bond or the covalent bond? So it depends on the number of electrons in the atom, particularly the number of the electron furthest away from the nucleus determine the atom's reactivity and hence its tendency to form a covalent or ionic bond. Now here the interpretation. Now when you talk about the, if suppose this is a nucleus, electron is revolving around like this and like this, but whenever the electron is going far away from the nucleus, the force of attraction between them is going to be less as compared to electron is very near to the nucleus. Correct? Yes. So now that last shell electron can be removed or can be another can be accepted. Yes or no? This is a possibility, and that is why these outermost electrons are the ones that are more likely to feel the presence of the other atoms, hence they ones involved in the bonding. See, earlier what we have studied in this case, in case of hydrogen, they has to be feel closer to each other. They have to feel and then they form the bonding. So same happen or same goes with this. So the outermost shell electron come closer to the another electron of the outermost shell of another atom. So when they feel closer, they form the bond. So who is playing a role in the bonding? the last shell electron. That is very, very important. So chemistry of an element depends almost entirely on the number of electrons and hence its atomic number. So here we're going to talk about the atomic number. The atomic number tells about how much electrons are present. According to that, we can find out how much electron present in a last shell. That is the interpretation of atomic number, and that is very, very important in point of view. Now, a chemical bond. Let's define the chemical bond. A chemical bond is thus defined as the force of attraction that holds various constituents like atoms, ions together. So what is the function of chemical bonding? They hold together. What kind of force it is? Attractive force or affinity force, we can say. What kind of constituent is hold like atoms and ions? So now there are three main types of the bonds that are formed: ionic, or it's also called electrovalent. Another one is a covalent. Third one is a covalent. In this section, we're going to talk about more and more in detail about ionic and electrovalent. This is a two session I'm going to conduct over here on this lesson. So earlier we're going to talk about what is ionic and covalent, and what is the remaining part will we cover in the next session. So chemical bond. A chemical bond is a force of attraction between the atoms that leads to the formation of a chemical compound. In this, we studied about a chemical bond is a force of attraction which holds a constituent. Yes or no? Yeah. If it holds a constituent, definitely it's going to rise to give something. That something is called formation of chemical compound. In case of hydrogen and chlorine, when they come closer, now they form hydrochloric acid. They are not no longer to be hydrogen or chlorine. Right now they form another molecule or another entity, we can say. Yes, the bond occurs because of, and this is how they form the bond. So in this case, what we have studied right now, so the bond occurs because of two factors, that is electrostatic force of attraction between the atoms of opposite charge, that is positive charge and negative charge, they form a bond, and through the sharing of electrons in a covalent bond. So this is how actually the chemical bond arises. So here let's just once again recall the things. Chemical bond is what? A force of attraction between the atoms, which in this we just understood that as a force of attraction which holds the various constituent to lead to the formation of the compounds. The bonds occur because of electrostatic force and through the sharing of electrons. If there is electrostatic force, that is called as the ionic one, we're going to study in the further slides. So atoms lose or gain or share the electron to attain the octet configuration and stability. Students, tell me what is the octet here or what is the duplet rule. When you talk about the octet rule and the duplet rule, that means it's all about the stability purpose of every element in the periodic table. What happened exactly is that in case of hydrogen and the helium, they have a two electron in the outermost shell. In case of helium, there are two electrons. In case of hydrogen, it's only one. Helium is a stable because it has a two electrons, but in case of hydrogen, it requires one more electron to get stabilized. So it's called a duplet. But when you talk about the other element in the whole periodic table, they follow the octet rule. That means in the last shell or the valence shell, they should possess 8 electrons, then only they qualified as a stability according to the noble gas configuration. So that's why they follow the octet configuration for the stability purpose. Okay, so they will lose or gain. For example, in case of sodium, it will be loose to complete the octet. But in case of chlorine, having the 7 electron in the last shell, it has to require one electron. So it has to be accept or gain the electron. And that's why he will complete his octet configuration. Have you got that? Got my point, students? Okay. The force of attraction is a result of the behavior of the outermost or a valence electron. Now, let's we discuss earlier. What about that? The last electron, or we can say a valence electrons, are literally far from the nucleus. So they can be moved, or they can feel the other atom's electrons, and they can lead to the formation of the bonding. Correct. So the force of attraction is a result of behavior of the outermost or valence electrons. So based on this force, different types of bonds are formed, giving to rise different properties in the compound. According to this, the different compounds are forming. Now, the strength of the chemical bond varies considerably, leading to the formation of the either strong or primary bonds and a weak or secondary bond. So it depends on this factors, what we discuss, is considerably leading to the formation of either strong or weak as a primary, secondary, which is a weak one. So strong bonds include the ionic or a covalent bonds and a coordinate compounds, or we can say coordinate covalent or a dative compounds, dating bonds. So strong bonds are majority because of the ionic and the electrovalent bond or a covalent bond. But when you talk about the weak bonds, that is arises or include the dipole-dipole interaction and the hydrogen bonding. So let's study about this, what is dipole and the hydrogen bonding. So in this case, we're going to talk about, let's talk about the HCl molecule. See, chlorine is a highly electronegativity, so it will snatch the electron from the hydrogen. So in this case, the electrons are near to the chlorine. So because of that, chlorine will have a partial negative charge, and hydrogen have a partial positive charge. You can say partial like this, but according to you can say positive and negative. So what happened in this case, as a chlorine is highly electronegativity, there is a charge shifting from the hydrogen towards the chlorine, and there is a formation of the poles, that is positive and negative, and this is called dipolar moment, and it's actually the weaker one. Okay, now let's talk about in a hydrogen bonding. See, in case of water, we can draw the structure like this. Correct, guys? Now, another water molecule is going to like this. But because of what? No, because of the electrons, or we can say lone pair of electrons of oxygen, there is a formation of bond with this oxygen, with this hydrogen. Have you got my point? So here there is a formation of bonding, and there are many, many hydrogen bonding will be formed in the water. And this is called a weak interaction force. Okay. So we just discuss about this hydrogen bonding and dipolar moment, which come under into the weaker bonds. There are three main types of atomic bonds are ionic, covalent and metallic bonds. So let's talk about the ionic, and we will compare about ionic and covalent. Okay, so in case of ionic, they are formed because of a non-directional interaction forces and electron transfer. They give structure of the high coordination, and there is an electrical conductivity at a low temperature. In case of covalent, what happened? They are formed because of the localized. In case of covalent, the electrons are localized, that means they share the electron. But in case of ionic, they are non-directional. So the force of attraction is very stronger in a covalent. Okay, in case of ionic, there is a higher conductivity, but in case of covalent, a low coordination and the low conductivity at a low temperature, and that is for pure crystal. Now let's talk about the metallic bonds. As the word suggests, metals has tendency to lose the electrons. You know about this. Why? Because they want to complete their octet. So as they lose electron, they act like an electron donor. Yes. Now, they are formed due to the non-directional large intermolecular force, and they have a large intermolecular force of attraction. So these are the things: ionic, covalent, and metallic bonds. Now let's talk about ionic or electrovalent bonds. Now, students, I'm going to ask you the question right now. See, ionic, I can understand there is a positive and negative cations and ions interaction is there. That's why it's called ionic bonding. But what do you mean by electrovalent bonding? Okay, electrovalent means there is an affinity towards the charge. Electrons is having negative charge. So there is a positive charge, negative charge. See, we can see your ions. When will be the ions form? Cations and ions, when will be the form? Whenever there is a lose or gain of electron, and that is called electrovalent bond. Okay. Now, ionic bonding is the complete transfer of valence electron between atoms. Ionic bonds occur between the metals, that is electron donors, and non-metals, that is electron acceptors. Because of the electrostatic force of attraction between the positive and negative ions, ionic or electrovalent bonds are formed under the conditions of a low ionization energy, high electron affinity, and high lattice energy. This is how they work. So let's talk about ionization energy. What is ionization energy? The amount of energy required to remove the electron, to add the electron into the outermost shell or a valence shell of an atom, it's called ionization energy. See, simply it means what? To form the ion. From the atoms, what you have to make? Ions you have to make. So high electron affinity and the high lattice energy. So when you talk about the high electron affinity, affinity towards electron is very high. In case of electronegative atoms such as chlorine, oxygen, nitrogen, fluorine, they are highly electronegative. They require an electron to complete their octet. And the high lattice energy. Lattice energy means what? A geometry regarding how the atom look like. Physical properties depends on the lattice energy. So this is why chemical bonding is very, very important in case of all aspects of the, yes, structure we can say, physical property we can say, in all aspects, yes. Now the question arises, why does ionic bonding occurs? What is the reason behind ionic bonding occurs? It occurs in the metals because metal have a few valence electron and metals tends to lose the electron to attain the octet configuration that we have discussed. And this is leads to the lose of electron to attain the octet configuration and achieve the noble gas configuration. See, every element in the periodic table wants to attain the stability as standard as the noble gas configuration. So it, in case of metal, they lose the electron. In case of non-metal, they gain the electron. In occurs in the non-metal, since non-metals readily accept the electron to achieve the noble gas configuration. So what happens? There is an interaction between metal and non-metal. Metal donate the electron and this non-metal accept the electron. So there is a formation of bonding. Have you got the point? Okay. Now we are going to talk about some characteristics of the ionic bond. And while reading out one characteristic, I'm going to explain some very, very important points. So please kindly pay attention. Now, let's talk about the first one. Ionic compounds have a high melting and the boiling points. Why they have a high and high melting point, boiling point? Because they have a strong force of interaction. They are dense because their crystalline forms contain crystal lattice of a tightly packed molecules. That is important. Their crystalline forms are always soluble in a water because the solubility in this case is much as compared to the other one. See, we have discussed about the hydrogen bonding, so the concept can be applicable in a crystalline manner as well. Now, crystals cannot conduct electricity in the solid state. So these are the four characteristics. We're moving to the next four characteristics. The chemical bond generates two oppositely charged ions. Yes, of course, positive and negative, and because of there is a attraction is there. But vice versa, we can say chemical bond generated. But when you cut the chemical bond, or we can say remove the chemical bond, or you provide the energy to break the bond, definitely there is a positive or negative ions. For example, take example of NaCl or HCl. It will be formed a positive and negative ions. Correct? Now, second point. Metals lose electron to become a positively charged cation, while non-metal accept those electrons to become a negatively charged anion. So here the concept of cation and the anion. Cation is a positively charged because they lose the electron. Anion accept the electron, that's why they are negatively charged. The charges on the anions and cations correspond to the number of electrons donate or receive. The net charge of the compound is calculated as a zero. This is very, very important point. Now, let's see the electron dot structure of hydrogen molecule. You can see hydrogen molecule here. Yes or no? Yes. Hydrogen molecule is here. When they combine, they will form this structure. Earlier, we also discussed they share the electron like this, and that is called electron dot structure. But actually, we are showing all the atoms, valence shell and all here. Because see, in case of hydrogen, it's very easy because it has only or it possesses only one electron. So it's very easy to understand. But what happens if the amount of electrons is much greater as compared to the hydrogen, as increasing order? So definitely, it's very difficult, or we can say it's complex to draw all the atoms and electrons, correct? So for that purpose, we have an electron dot structure. So let's discuss this. Draw the electron dot structure of following, that is MgCl2. See, Mg is a metal, that is magnesium. Chlorine is there, non-metal is there. See, magnesium and chlorine is there. Now tell me one thing, Cl2. Why there is a Cl2? Why not only Cl? Because magnesium has a charge 2+, chlorine has a -1. So there is an interaction of two chlorine molecule. Sorry, you have to say atoms, correct? Many students make that mistake. They call as a molecule, but you don't have to do this. You have to call as a atoms. One chlorine molecule attaches to the magnesium, but one magnesium attaches to the two chlorine atoms. How? This is the representation. See here, magnesium is sharing the two electrons, one gained by the one chlorine, another gained by the another atom, another electron is gained by another chlorine, and they form the bonding in this manner. Now, electron dot structure in magnesium, we have plotted the two dot. That means we are considering only the last shell electron. That is the beauty of electron dot structure. We are just specifying the last shell or valence shell electron. In case of chlorine, they have 7 electrons, so they need one. So they get the electron from the magnesium and they form the bond. In case of NaCl, Na plus Cl minus is there. This is how they form the bond. Okay, just observe the students what I'm trying to convey. Okay. Now I'm going to ask you the question. You have to give the answer. In case of sodium, what is the charge? +1. In chlorine, what is the charge? -1. So they sodium. How many electron donated by sodium? 1. How many electron gained by the chlorine? 1. So they have a plus and minus charge. So this is how they form the bond. Now let's talk about the characteristic of the electrovalent compound. Crystal structure and the physical nature we're going to talk about. So let's talk about the crystal structure. Now student, for that crystal structure, you should know about the lattice. Whatever I told in the last slide, you should recollect that. Okay, I'm going to tell you. Don't worry about it. In the solid state, electrovalent compounds, that is anions and cations, are arranged in a regular manner. Positive, negative, positive, negative, negative, positive, positive, negative. Like kind of this fashion manner or regular manner they are attached. This is a crystal in which anions are surrounded by the definite number of cations and vice versa. See, anions can be surrounded by the cations or cations can be surrounded by anions. That is a regular manner and that is a fashion which is recorrect or regenerated again and again, and that is called crystal structure. So what is the amorphous? Is a powder line structure. There is no definite structure. But when you talk about the crystal structure, that means they have a particular shape. For that particular shape, you have a repeating molecule, repeating unit, and that is called made up of cation and anion. Okay, so that is the crystal structure. So can you tell me in a nutshell, crystal structure is nothing but what? Arrangement of cation and anion, and the chemical bonding plays an important role in this. Why? Because bonding actually leads to the crystalline structure. So we can say in a nutshell, according to this information, can we say that the geometry of the molecule depends on the chemical bonding. It can be ionic or a covalent, and on the basis of this, the geometry is represented. Yes or no? Yes, correct. Now, physical nature. Let's talk about the physical nature right now. Ionic or electrovalent compounds are generally hard. Their hardness increases with the increased ionic charge and the decreasing distance between the ions. So here, what we have discussed right now, hardness. Because of what? Increasing with increasing ionic charge. As the ionic charge increases, the hardness increases, and that is called physical nature. So you can represent that the strong the chemical bond, crystalline structure is strong. the strong the hardness, you can say the hardness is strong because of what? The ionic charge is much greater as compared to the smaller charges. Okay. So this is how you interpret the information, correct? Okay. Now let's talk about the solubility. What do you mean by solubility, students? You can say water is a universal solvent because whatever you add in that, it gets soluble, except some few. Okay, so positive ions or ionic compounds attaches to the negative part of a polar solvent, and negative ions of ionic compound attach with the positive part of the polar solvent. Therefore, ionic or electrovalent compounds are soluble in the polar solvents like water, but it is insoluble in non-polar solvents such as the benzene, ether, and alcohol. So why water is known as a polar? Because it has a charges, positive and negative. How? Just we studied about the hydrogen bonding. So some way we have to connect those points. Okay. So positive and negative. Let's take example of NaCl. When you add the NaCl, like this, Na and Cl, they dissociate Na plus Cl minus inside the water. So this is how positive ions and negative ions get aparted in case of. So this is called a solubility. That means the bonding is breaking and they form their respective ions. Okay, according to the atomic structure. Now let's talk about the melting point and the boiling point. Electrovalent or ionic compounds have a high melting point and the boiling point because they need a large amount of energy to break the strong ionic bond. So whenever there is a strong ionic bond like this, they need a lot of energy to break it. And what is that energy? Heat energy. So let's talk about boiling point, the amount of energy required. See, maybe it is melting or boiling, you are actually providing the energy to break those bonds. See, tell me one thing, in case of solid, they are closely packed like this manner. But whenever you heat it, they start moving apart. So what exactly happened? The bond is breaking amongst them. So you're providing energy in the form of heat. It may be boiling, it can be melting. So this is how it works. Have you got my point, students? So right now we have covered some points. We are going to discuss it, or we are going to talk in a nutshell what we have discussed. So we have discussed about ionic bonding, then covalent bonding, that is sharing of electron. Then we have talked about duplet and the octet rule. Then we have talked about the physical properties, solubilities. Okay, so these are the points, very, very important. So in this session, we have covered this much points. Okay, I hope you understood that. Okay, so thank you for paying attention. Now in the next session, we're going to talk about the rule of octet duplet in detail manner and how to draw the structures. What is the impact of that? We're going to talk about. Okay, so thank you for paying attention.